Now we move on to the question and answer session. Before we begin, let me lay down the rules so that we can have the session in a very smooth fashion. Please form a queue at one of the four mics provided to you. One mic is in the ladies section. There are three mics in the gents section, one at the backside, one on my right, and one here on my left. While posing the questions, please state your name and profession. Please note that this is a question time, not a lecture time, so be precise and to the point when you pose your question. I request the volunteers who are handling the mic to give preference to our non-Muslim brothers who would be in the queue while posing the question. Please bring the non-Muslim brothers at the front. Preference is given to the non-Muslim brothers to pose the questions.
Good evening, Dr. Zakir. My name is Roberto. I'm doing BDS in Chennai, Savita Dental College. As Dr. Zakir said, God is a unique creator. There is only one. Second thing, you said God created human by out of love. Third, God has created wealth, poor, healthy, and weakness is all because of a test. Similarly, in Christian, they believe God is one. Second point, God created human out of love. Third point, it's the same thing. All this thing is because of a test by the God. So I just want to have an answer from you. Don't mistake, I'm not a Christian.
The brother asked a question that even in Christianity, like Islam, God is one and God loves the creation. And he further said, then what is the difference? You want to know the difference between Islam and Christianity or?
It's not the difference. What is the most convincing thing you think that you say that other than Islam, any other type of worship is non-acceptable?
That's a very good question, the brother. Now the question has come to forth that first there were just blank statements. If there's a question mark, it's a question. If it's a statement, we have to try and find the question. What is the difference between Islamic form of worship as compared to other form of worship? What is so unique? When Christianity also says God is one, Christianity says that God also loves. Islam says God is one. Islam says God also loves the creation. Islam says worship. Christianity says worship. What is the difference between the worship of Islam and Christianity? Or what is the uniqueness about Islam as compared to other religions? Mainly talking about Christianity. Brother, on the face of it, if you read the Quran correctly, and the interpretation I gave in my talk, and if you read the Bible correctly, the correct interpretation, we believe that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he was one of the mightiest messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No Muslim is a Muslim if he does not believe in Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. We believe that he was born miraculously without any male intervention. We believe that he was the Messiah, translated Christ. We believe that he healed those born blind and lepers with God's permission. We believe that he gave life to the dead with God's permission. But there are parting of ways. There are many Christians who say that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he claimed divinity. Now the difference between what the Bible says and the difference between what the Christians assume and what they practice, the difference between that. So many Christians say that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he claimed divinity. So when they say God is one, they say Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, is God. Which we Muslims take objection to. There is not a single unequivocal statement in the complete Bible where Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, himself says that I am God, or where he says worship me. So the form of worship for the normal Christian is worshipping Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. And I repeat my statement. There is not a single unequivocal statement in the complete Bible where Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, himself says that I am God, or where he says worship me. If any Christian can show me any unequivocal statement in the Bible where Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says I am God, or where he says worship me, I, Dr. Zakir Naik, I am ready to accept Christianity today. I am ready to put my head on the guillotine. I don't speak on behalf of my other Muslim brothers, because if you read the Bible, it is mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 14, verse number 28. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said that my Father is greater than I. Gospel of John, chapter number 10, verse number 29. My Father is greater than all. Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 12, verse number 28. I, with the Spirit of God, cast out devils. Gospel of Luke, chapter number 11, verse number 20. I, with the finger of God, cast out devils. Gospel of John, chapter number 5, verse number 30. I can of my own self do nothing. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is just. For I seek not my will, but the will of my Father. Anyone who says, I seek not my will, but the will of Almighty God, is a Muslim. Therefore, I said in my talk that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was a Muslim. Quran says that in Surah Al-Imran, chapter 3, verse 52. It's further mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 17, verse number 3. This is life eternal, so that you may know Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. It's mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 14, verse number 24. The words you hear are not mine, but my Father's who has sent me. It's clearly mentioned in the book of Acts, chapter number 2, verse number 22. Ye men of Israel, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God amongst you by wonders and miracles which God did by him, and you are witness to it. A man approved of God amongst you by wonders and miracles which God did by him, and you are witness to it. So Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was one of the mightiest messengers of God, but he never claimed divinity. He never said you should worship me. But unfortunately, the Christian church today, they teach that salvation. Bible also talks about heaven, talks about hell, but the purpose of existence is not mentioned in detail. It's not mentioned at all except what Paul has mentioned. Paul mentioned in Corinthians, chapter number 15, he says, in the first Corinthians chapter number 15, that if Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, died not for your sins, your faith is in vain and everything is in vain. That means Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he died for your sins, according to Paul. And they quote the verse of the Bible, Gospel of John, chapter number 3, verse number 16, that for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, whosoever believeth in him shall not die but have everlasting life. So the concept of salvation, according to the church, is that you believe Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, died for your sins, and you shall go to Jannah, you shall go to paradise, which is not mentioned because the word begotten from Gospel of John, chapter number 3, verse number 16, has been thrown out by 32 scholars of the highest eminence from the RSV, Revised Standard Version of the Bible, as a concoction, as a fabrication, as an interpolation. So what they're following is more of Pauline Christianity. But Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, when a person approaches him in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 19, verse number 16 and 17, that good master, what good things shall I do so that I shall gain eternal life? What good thing shall I do so that I shall go to Jannah, paradise? So Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, replies, why thou callest me good? There is none good except one, that is Almighty God. And if thou want to enter eternal life, you follow the commandments. He didn't say that if you want to go to Jannah, want to go to paradise, you believe that I died for your sins. He never said that. He said, follow the commandments. And Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, it's mentioned in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 5, verse number 17 to 20. That think not that I am come to destroy the law of the prophets. I have come not to destroy, but to fulfill. Unless the heaven and the earth pass away, not one jot or tittle shall be passed away from the law until all be fulfilled. And whosoever shall keep the commandments and teach men to do so shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. And whosoever shall break one of the least commandments will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. Unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, in no way shall you enter into paradise. Because if you want to be a good Christian, you have to follow all the commandments. There's only one God, you should not do idol worship, all what Moses, peace be upon him, said. So here we analyze, if we do a research of the biblical scriptures, it is actually believing in one God, not Trinity. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Nisa, chapter 4, verse 171, وَلَا تَقُولُوا سَلَاسَا. Don't say Trinity. إِنْتَوْ خَيْرُ لَكُمْ. This has stopped, it's better for you. So if you say God is three in one, it is shirk. You won't get salvation. There's no statement at all about Trinity. The word Trinity does not exist anywhere in the Bible, but it's there in the Quran. Besides Surah Nisa, chapter 4, verse 171, it's also there in Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 73. It says, لَقَدْ كَفْرَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهُ سَلِسُ سَلَاسَا. They are doing kufr, they are blaspheming those who say that God is three in one. The word Trinity doesn't exist anywhere in the Bible. The closest statement is the first epistle of John, chapter number 5, verse number 7, which says, for there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one. And this verse of the Bible, by 32 scholars of the highest eminent Christian scholars, in the Revised Standard Version of the Bible, they've thrown this verse out of the Bible as an interpolation, as a fabrication, as a concoction. So the verse which comes closest to the Trinity, doesn't mention Trinity, but comes closest, is thrown out by the scholars of Christianity as a fabrication. So if we analyze, if you want to check what is right in the Bible, here is the Furqan. This is the criteria. It will tell you what is right, what is wrong. And if you compare with this, and even today if you read the Bible never claimed that Jesus is God, peace be upon him. It says you should worship only one God. And when Jesus Christ, peace be upon us, asked that which is the first of the commandments, it's mentioned in the Gospel of Mark, chapter number 12, verse number 29, it says, Shema Israelo Adnael Hainu Adnechad. It's a Hebrew quotation which means, Hear, O Israel, the Lord, our God is one Lord. So the problem is that if you read the Bible, the exact purpose of creation is not mentioned. It is vague. The Christian church has taken up a teaching of Paul, St. Paul, and says that you believe Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, died for your sins, and you will go to heaven. Then you do anything, you rob, you rape, you do anything. If he's paid for our sins, if Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, paid for our sins, I can do anything. For example, someone tells me to a restaurant, go to the restaurant, eat what you want, I've paid your bill, I can eat anything. Chicken, mutton, biryani, anything I can eat. So if Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, has died for my sins, then you can commit any sin and you go to heaven. Only have to believe that he died for your sins. So this is the concept of the church, which is not what the Bible mentions. And you can refer to my video cassette, Similarities Between Islam and Christianity, which gives the similarities. That's the reason I say that Jesus Christ taught nothing but Islam, that is submitting your will to Almighty God.
Can we have the next question from brother over here? Please state your name and profession as well.
Retired superintendent. At the outset, I am extremely delighted to be here, even though I am not a Muslim. In the Old Testament of the Bible, it is noted as that God created the day and night in the first day. After that, God created the sun and the moon. How is it possible for the day and night without the sun? Likewise, in Quran, it is mentioned that the sun rotates the earth. As per chapter 21, verse 22 of Quran, God controls the universe. My doubt is as to whether God had mistaken when he creates the universe. I think the contents in the Bible and Quran are against the science. Please explain.
Brother, can I have your name? And can you repeat what is about the Quran? I didn't hear correctly. Your name first. And what do you mention about the Quran? Quran says that the sun
Quran
rotates.
Quran in Surah number 6, I think.
Surah number 6, the sun rotates. You said 21, 22. Chapter 21, verse 22.
Chapter number 21, verse 22. 22.
The sun rotates.
No. In Surah number 6, I think. But in chapter 21, verse 22, God controls the universe.
So that goes against science, according
to you. Yes.
Brother asked a question. He said that he has read the Bible. He quoted a few verses of the Bible and of the Quran, didn't give the reference. He said that the Bible says that Almighty God created day and the night in the first day. What he's quoting is the first book of the Bible, the book of Genesis, chapter number 1, verse number 3. It says that Almighty God created the day and the night and on the first day. And further, if you read in Genesis chapter number 1, verse number 13 to 19, it says Almighty God created the sun on the fourth day. I'm giving you the references also. So doesn't this go against science? I do agree with you, it goes against science. And I had a debate with Dr. William Campbell in USA. Dr. William Campbell, he is a missionary and a medical doctor and got a PhD in writing a book against the Quran. And in that debate on the Quran and the Bible in the light of science, even I posed this question, even he couldn't answer. So I do agree there's a problem in the Bible. Now coming to your question, that the Quran says that Almighty God controls the universe. Regarding the Bible, yes, I do agree with you, Bible is against established science. Regarding a question that Quran says Almighty God controls the universe, you didn't say that sun rotates. That's what I heard. Therefore, I'm asking you to repeat. Why are you repeating? I heard that. And it gave reference, chapter 21, verse 22, the reference is wrong. The real reference is Surah Anbiya, chapter 21, verse 33, not 22. Verse 33. Here's the Quran. I'm speaking from memory. I'm not a computer. I'll give the reply, brother. After I reply, whatever query you have, no problem, brother. You asked the question, let me reply. After I finish my reply, you can ask another 20 questions. But you asked the question, I was listening to you carefully. Now you listen to my answer. And after I finish my answer, if you have any query you can ask, I will give you enough time. Even chairman doesn't agree, I'll request him to give you time because you are delighted to come here. We are more delighted that you are here. The brother said that the Quran says in Surah Anbiya chapter 21, verse 22, it's actually verse 33, that the sun rotates. What he's quoting in the verse of the Quran of Surah Anbiya chapter 21, verse 33, he says, هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارَ. It is Allah who has created night and the day, وَشَمْسَ وَالْقَمَرَ, sun and the moon, كُلٌّ فِي فَلَقِهِ يَسْبَحُونَ, each one traveling in orbit with his own motion. And this mistake was even taken out by Taslima Nasreen. You know Taslima Nasreen? Heard of her? From Bangladesh. She said that if a book believe that the sun rotates around the earth, then how can we advance? So the Quran has to be changed. Nauz billah. The problem is that a view should be changed and she should read the Quran correctly. The Quran says, هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارَ. It is Allah who has created the night and the day. وَشَمْسَ وَالْقَمَرَ, the sun and the moon. كُلٌّ فِي فَلَقِ يَسْبَحُونَ, each one traveling in orbit with its own motion. Nowhere does the Quran say that the sun rotates or revolves around the earth. Nowhere. What does the Quran say? The sun and the moon rotate and revolve. Nowhere does it say around the earth. The word earth is not there in this verse. It says, هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارَ. It is Allah who has created night and day. وَشَمْسَ وَالْقَمَرَ, the sun and the moon. كُلٌّ فِي فَلَكِ يَسْبَحُونَ, each one traveling in orbit with its own motion. When I was in school, I had learned that the sun was stationary. It did not rotate about its own axis. It revolved in the universe. The whole solar system is revolving. But when I passed my school in 1982, I had learned the sun was stationary, not rotate. But this verse of the Quran says, the Arabic word yasbuhun is derived from the word sabaha, which describes the motion of a moving body. If I use this Arabic word sabaha for a person on the floor, it will not mean he's rolling, it will mean he's walking or running. If I use this Arabic word for a person in the water, it will not mean he's floating, it will mean he's swimming. When Allah uses this word for a celestial body, it doesn't mean it is flying, it means it is rotating about its own axis. So Quran says the sun and the moon, besides revolving, they are also rotating about their own axis. When I read the verse of the Quran, I said, but I read in my school book, the sun does not rotate. Today, science has advanced and we come to know we can have the image of the sun on a tabletop. And we see that the sun has got black spots. And these black spots take about 25 days to complete one rotation, indicating the sun takes approximately 25 days to complete one rotation. So what I learned in school in 1982, today science says it is wrong. Quran has mentioned this not 20 years back, 1400 years back. What I learned in school 20 years back. The Quran says, what I learned is wrong. First I got a shock. But then when I did more research, I realized that the Quran is right. Quran is not wrong. My science book was wrong. And Taslima Nasreen, where did she put the word earth inside? I don't know. Does she know Arabic? Can she read English? English translation doesn't say that. She assumed that when the Quran says the sun revolves, it revolves around the earth. That's assumption. So her assumption is wrong. Alhamdulillah, Quran is not wrong. And I do agree with you that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He controls this universe. That's the reason, according to Francis Bacon, the great philosopher, he said, little knowledge of science makes you an atheist, but in-depth knowledge of science makes you a believer in one God. Hope that answers the question.
Do you have another question?
If you have any question, you're most welcome. If you have any counter question, you're most welcome, brother. We love you.
Sir, I'm not sure the chapter number.
No problem. I never criticize you. I just corrected you. I have to just tell the right thing. If you have given something wrong reference, if someone opened, I corrected you. I didn't say that you have to know by heart. Neither are you a computer, neither am I a computer.
But I think it is in the surah number 8. I think the sun is rotating earth.
It's nowhere in the Quran. I'm telling you, the verse you're quoting is Surah Anbiya, chapter 21, verse 33, even quoted by Taslima Nasreen and hundreds of critics of Islam. Nowhere in Surah Anfal, chapter 8, does it say that the sun, nowhere in the Quran it says the sun rotates. The closest misunderstanding you can have, if you don't know Arabic or don't read the translation correctly, is Surah Anbiya. So your first reference was very close, only 11 verses difference. So your reference was right, chapter number was right, 21. But the verse was not 22, it was verse 33. Here's the Quran.
No. Chapter number 21, verse 22. The God controls the universe.
Acha, now one more. The God controls the universe. That's what I'm telling you. Science hasn't advanced so far to come to know about the reality of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I've given the talk, is the Quran God's word? And I've proved scientifically the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I would request one of the volunteers to present my video cassette to him. I request Brother Ashraf that you can ask one of the volunteers. I'll give you a gift, a video cassette. Is the Quran God's word? Which has mentioned several scientific facts and has even proved scientifically the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, today scientists, top scientists are not eliminating God.
They are not the eliminating models of God. La ilaha. They are not eliminating God, but eliminating models of God. La ilaha illallah. You understand? So today, scientists, top scientists in the world, they all believe in God. Most, some may have deviated, but most of them agree there has to be a creator about the creation of the universe. Today, science tells us, how did the universe come into creation? How? By the Big Bang, correct?
Yes,
very good. Big Bang. That today, scientists, they tell us that first there was a primary nebula, the whole universe, then there was secondary separation, a Big Bang, which gave rise to galaxies, which gave rise to stars, the planets, the sun, the moon, and the earth we live in. This is called the Big Bang. When did you come to know about this Big Bang? 20 years back, 30 years back, 40 years back, correct? Allah says in the Quran in Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 30, Allah says 1400 years ago, Allah says that do not the unbelievers see that the heavens and the earth were joined together. Do not the unbelievers see anna samawati wal arda, that the heavens and the earth were joined together and we clove them asunder. So Allah says that the heavens and the earth were joined together and we clove them asunder. This Big Bang was today the scientists talk about is mentioned in the Quran 1400 years back in a nutshell. Who could have mentioned this? That time science wasn't advanced. Who? The creator. So like that, I've given a full talk. You can refer to my video cassette of Quran Modern Science and is the Quran God's word. Inshallah, inshallah, if you watch it with an open mind, you have to be convinced that there's one God and he is the creator of the universe.
Thank you.
Can we have the next question from the mic at the back?
My name is Ravi and I'm a teacher at IIT. You said love. My feelings are कि प्रेम अगर मैं भगवान से प्रेम करता हूं तो ये सारे ऑनेस्टीज एंड अदर जो अच्छे गुण आपने बताए हैं मतलब आदमी में होने चाहिए एक सही अल्लाह का बंदे में होने चाहिए वो सारे गुण तो अपने आप आ जाते हैं फिर क्या ये नियम जो अल्लाह ने कुरान में बताए हैं आपके क्या ये नियम जरूरी हैं अगर मैं भगवान से सिर्फ प्रेम करता हूं तो क्या ये काफी नहीं है हमारे लिए अपने अल्लाह के तरफ प्रति अपना gratefulness या praise प्रकट करने के लिए।
The brother posed the question in Hindi. I'll give the translation in English. He said that God loves, even he loves God. Human beings love God. The moment you love God, all these good qualities I mentioned about honesty, about charity come automatically. So is it required that we should follow the commandments mentioned in the Quran? Is it a requirement? Brother, if everything comes automatically, you will automatically follow what is mentioned in the Quran. But everything doesn't come automatically to everyone. You understand? So what Allah wants, if you love your creator, for example, I say that I love my mother. I love my mother. My mother tells me that my son, don't tell lies. No, I love you, mother. But what's the harm in lying? My mother says, get for me a glass of water. Mother, I love you very much. But I don't get the glass of water. I am sick. Please get some tablets. Mother, I love you very much. If I don't obey the commandments of my mother, what is the use of this love? It is useless. It is a lip service. Therefore, Allah says in the Quran in Surah Ankabut, chapter 29, verse number 2, just by saying you believe, Allah will test you. If you say you love, मैं अल्लाह को लव करता हूँ अल्लाह विल नॉट लीव यू अल्लाह विल टेस्ट यू सो जस्ट बाय सेइंग यू लव अल्लाह और जस्ट बाय सेइंग आई बिलीव इन अल्लाह बिलीव इन गॉड अल्लाह विल श्योरली टेस्ट यू सो दिस लाइफ इज अ टेस्ट नाउ व्हेन यू गो फॉर द टेस्ट इफ यू डोंट नो द रूल्स एंड रेगुलेशन ऑफ द टेस्ट देयर विल बी अ प्रॉब्लम फॉर एग्जाम्पल इफ यू सिट फॉर एन एग्जामिनेशन फर्स्ट यू ट्राई एंड फाइंड आउट व्हाट इज द पोर्शन ऑफ द एग्जामिनेशन एंड देन यू स्टडी दैट पोर्शन सो व्हाट अल्लाह हैज सेड सर्टेन थिंग्स आर इनबॉर्न आई एग्री विद यू Certain things, qualities, honesty, charity, it comes inborn. Allah has put. But many things we don't know. Not having alcohol is not inborn. Certain things that charity is inborn. May come, like if anyone is, suppose, anyone is tortured, you feel hurt. Certain things are inborn. Not to gamble is not inborn. So certain things are inborn, certain things are not. So what we have to do, we have to follow the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah says, this life is a test. So unless you do not read the commandment of Almighty God, how will you pass the test? Why do I say read the Quran? Because this is the only book which is the revelation of Almighty God, which has remained in pristine purity. According to Sir William Moore, who is a staunch critic of Islam, he was forced to write
Forced means he was compelled, he had no option. That there's no book on the earth which has remained as pure as the Quran for the past 12 centuries. He said this 200 years back. Even a critic, he had no option. He couldn't lie here, he had to say. So compared to all the other scriptures of Almighty God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he sent several revelations. By name, you know four: Torah, Zabur, Injil, and the Quran. Torah is the wahi, the revelation was given to Moses, peace be upon him. Zabur is the wahi, the revelation was given to David, peace be upon him. Injil is the wahi, the revelation given to Jesus, peace be upon him. And Quran is the last and final revelation which was given to the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Otherwise, Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Ra'd, chapter 13, verse 38, we have sent a revelation every age. There were many more revelations sent. By the passage of time, they have got corrupted. The only one which has remained in pristine purity is the Quran. That's why I say that if you want to follow the real command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, follow this. And if you being a Hindu, if you ask me, how do I prove it? You have to come for my talk on the 18th of January on Sunday for similarities between Hinduism and Islam.
Can we have the next question from the brother's side?
As Dr. Sakir gave the explanation just now, is totally agreeable and I accept it, because I'm not a Christian and I'm a person who thinks God should be there. As a cell phone is here, there must be someone created it. Otherwise, it's not existence in this world. Similarly, I believe in God, but I don't have a religion. And as Dr. Sakir said, any other religion or worshipping other than Muslim is a sin. But how will you convince this little man over here that this only religion is only Islam and nothing else? But maybe the people, other religion thinks, or maybe you people are doing the sin. Because you are telling we are sinning. And you know, these things keeps on happening between religion and religion.
The brother asked a very good question. He gave a Christian name, if I heard it correctly, but said he's not a Christian. He says he believes in God. If there's a cell phone, it has a creator, so that way he believes in God. Very good, alhamdulillah, congratulations. But he says that, how can you prove to me that I should only follow Islam? That's a very good question. Brother, Islam is an Arabic word, you may not know the meaning. So forget Arabic, leave it aside. What you should follow is, Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 19, Inna Deena Indallah al-Islam, the only religion acceptable in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is Islam, which is peace acquired by submitting your will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you believe in God, that He is there, you don't believe in religion, what is the definition of religion? Religion means believing in God. So if you believe in God and say don't believe in religion, you're contradicting. By definition of Oxford Dictionary, religion means believing in a supernatural being or God that deserves obedience. So if you believe there is God, you also have to obey Him, right or wrong? That's a different thing. You may not know which book is God's book. You understand? So if you believe in God, do you want to obey this creator or not? Yes or no?
Yeah, but first finish. You have to be convincing, right?
That's right, I agree with you. I'm not telling you, but you have to obey the creator. Now, what the creator said, you have to find out. Correct? So now the brother agrees that there's a creator, he believes in God, and he agrees that he should obey that creator. The same thing God is telling. The only way of life acceptable is submitting your will to God. That's it. Now, what is submitting? That's a different question. Correct? Forget the word Muslim. Forget the word Islam. Muslim means one who submits his will to Almighty God. If you submit your will to God, in Arabic, you call Muslim. Just by telling your name is Zakir or Abdullah or Sultan, you don't become Muslim. If I say my name is Zakir, I don't become a Muslim. If someone says his name is Muhammad, doesn't become a Muslim. Muslim by definition means a person who acquires peace, one who submits his will to Almighty God. Now you want to know that how will you say that this is the right will of God, correct? For that, you have to refer to my video cassette, Is the Quran God's Word? Which is proof scientifically that this is the word of God which you and I believe in. You and I believe in. This is the same word of God. For that, refer to my video cassette. It is approximately 4 hours. I don't intend giving a lecture and a question answer 4 hours here. And tomorrow you can come for my talk, Sharia. Sharia means the law of Allah, law of Islam. Barbaric or perfect? If you hear that talk, it will partly convince you. For complete answer,
refer to my video cassette, is the Quran God's word. And inshallah, inshallah, you'll be convinced that this is the only way which is right. Names, don't go on Arabic names. Don't look at people, what people do, don't follow them. Don't judge Islam by what the followers are doing. If you want to judge how good a car is, if a driver does not know how to drive the car and he bangs up the car, who will you blame, the driver or the car? Driver. So don't judge Islam by looking at the Muslims. Judge Islam by the authentic source of the Quran. And if you judge according to this, if you want to judge the car, you'll go at the catalog, what is the speed of that Mercedes car, what is the safety measures, what is the average, etc., etc. Or you judge by putting a driver behind the seat who's an expert driver. So if you want to observe a human being, to know Islam is, the best example is the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam.
The next question from brother here.
Yes. I'm Prasanna. I'm doing my MBBS. Sir, you said that it was wrong to kill animals other than necessity, that is for target practice, etc. So in the present day, a man can live very comfortable and healthy life by being a vegetarian. So do you think it's wrong to kill animal for just for the sake of satisfying our taste buds?
Brother Prasanna has asked a very good question, very relevant question to the topic. When I said that you should not kill any animals, they are creation of Allah, unless you want for food, you cannot target practice. So why do the Muslims kill animals? You can lead a healthy life according to him, being an MBBS student. So why only kill the animals for taste? Brother, point number one. A Muslim can be a very good Muslim even by being a pure vegetarian. There is no verse in the Quran or Hadith which says you should compulsory, fard, have non-veg or have flesh. You can be a very good Muslim by being a pure vegetarian. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, in Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 1, you can have all the animals which are lawful for you, all four-footed animals which are lawful for you, with the exception named. Allah says in Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 5, that Almighty God has created animal for you so that you can eat the meat. Allah says in Surah Mu'minun, chapter number 23, verse number 21, that verily in the cattle is a sign for you. From among the body, you get a milk for you to drink. And from it, you derive warmth. And of the meat, you can eat. So when our Creator Almighty God gives us permission to have these meat, why should we not have it? Now coming to your argument, that in this meat, you being an MBBS student, even I'm a medical doctor, I've passed my MBBS. And you being an MBBS student, you might have read, I don't know which year you're in, first year also, you might have read that there are certain amino acids which are not synthesized in the body, which are known as essential amino acids. There are 8 amino acids. Now these essential amino acids have to be given in the external diet. If you don't take in the external diet, it can cause loss to your body. No vegetable on the face of the earth gives you all the 8 essential amino acids. No vegetable. The only food which gives you all the 8 essential amino acids is the meat, fish, the flesh foods. Flesh food is rich in protein, rich in vitamins, rich in iron. It is healthy. But yet I do know, if you want, you can remain healthy even by abstaining from non-veg food. You can. By having a proper diet and checking up and etc. You can. I'm not saying you cannot remain healthy. But when the food is healthy, why abstaining from it? The reason people give is that you're hurting animals, which will come to it later. Now, if you analyze the set of teeth of the herbivorous animals, the cow, the goat, the sheep, they have flat set of teeth. They only have vegetables. They will never touch flesh, never. If you analyze the set of teeth of the carnivorous animals, tiger, leopard, lion, they have canine set of teeth. They have pointed teeth. They only have flesh. They never touch grass. If you analyze the human being's teeth, if you go and look in the mirror, if I go and look in the mirror, we find that Almighty God has given us flat teeth as well as pointed teeth. If Almighty God wanted us to have only vegetables, why did he give us the canine teeth? Now, you are a medical student. The canine teeth is for flesh food. So this proves that Almighty God gave us for having non-veg food. Furthermore, the digestive system of the herbivorous animals, cow, goat, sheep, they cannot digest flesh. They can only digest vegetables. The digestive system of the carnivorous animals, tiger, leopard, lion, can only digest flesh. They cannot digest vegetables. But the digestive system of the human being, you being a medical student, know we can digest non-veg also and veg also. Vegetables also, flesh food also. Even flesh food. If Almighty God wanted us to have only vegetables, why did he give us a digestive system that can digest both? but natural to have it. Now coming to your question, that there is a misconception amongst the Hindus that the Hindu scripture does not permit them to have non-veg. I quoted the Quran. If you read the Hindu scriptures, brother, if you read Manusmriti chapter number 5, verse number 30-31, it says that if you eat the flesh of the animals which are meant to be eaten, you're not doing a sin, because Almighty God has created some animal to eat and some to be eaten. Manusmriti chapter number 5, verse 31, that if you sacrifice the animal, the sacrificial animal, you're not doing a sin. Manusmriti chapter number 5, verse number 39-40 says that Almighty God has created certain animals to be sacrificed. So if you kill the animal to be sacrificed, you're not killing. Manusmriti chapter number 5, verse number 41-42 says that a Brahmin who has knowledge, who knowingly sacrifices an animal, even the animal goes to heaven and even the Brahmin goes to heaven. Furthermore, in Rig Veda, book number 10, hymn number 27, verse number 2, a person says that I'm going to go for war. When I come back, prepare for me a great bull. Furthermore, Rig Veda, book number 10, hymn number 28, verse number 4, it says that Indra, he says that prepare for me bulls to eat. Buffalo, bulls to eat. And if you read the Mahabharata, Anushasan Parv, chapter number 88, if you read that, this is also mentioned in Manusmriti, chapter number 3, verse number 266 and 277. Yudhishthir, he asked Bhishma, what should we give in the yagna, in the puja, in sacrifice, so that our ancestors will be satisfied? So Bhishma replies that if you give herbs and shrubs, vegetables, our ancestors will be satisfied for 1 month. If you give fish, they'll be satisfied for 2 months. If you give meat, they'll be satisfied for 3 months. If you give hare, rabbit, they'll be satisfied for 4 months. If you give goat meat, they'll be satisfied for 5 months. If you give bacon, for 6 months. If you give deer, for 7 months. If you give birds, for 8 months. And the menu continues. This is scripture of Hindus. It further says that if you give a buffalo for 11 months, and if you give cow for 12 months, and rhinoceros, inexhaustibly. So even according to Hindu scriptures, it gives you permission to have non-veg, including beef. I'm not saying this. All the references are there. You can check it up. It's absolutely correct. Now coming to the logical point of it, that why do the human beings have to harm the animals when we can live without eating non-veg? The reason people give that killing an animal is a great sin and killing a plant is a less sin because plants don't have life. This was the logic. Previously, Hindu sages and Sant, they had non-veg, they had beef also, but they were influenced by the Jains of the Ahimsa philosophy who believed that plants have got no life, therefore eating a plant is a lesser sin as compared to eating an animal. But today you know and even I know that plants have got life. So now the logic has changed. They say, okay, Brother Zakir, we agree plants have got life, but plant can't feel pain. Therefore, killing a plant is a lesser sin than killing an animal. Today, science has further advanced and you have come to know that even the plants can feel pain. The plants have a nervous system. They can feel pain. They can even cry. They can even feel happy. They even feel sad. But the cry of the plant cannot be heard by the human beings because the human beings can only hear between a frequency of 20 cycles per second to 20,000 cycles per second. Anything below and above, they can't hear. You may be aware of a silent dog whistle. The dog can hear up to 40,000 cycles per second. So the whistle has a frequency above the human frequency, more than 20,000 cycles per second, but below 40,000 cycles per second, the master blows the whistle, human being can't hear, the dog hears and comes. So even the plants cry, but we can't hear. Just because we can't hear, that doesn't mean that we can torture them, if you say it's torturing. There was one person who argued with me and told me, Brother Zakir, I agree with you, plants have got life, plants can feel pain, but the plants have got only two or three senses. Animals have got five senses. Therefore, killing a plant is a lesser sin as compared to killing an animal. I told him, okay, brother, for sake of argument, I agree with you. Plants have got two or three senses, animals have got five senses. But suppose you have a brother, he's born deaf and dumb, two senses less. Can't speak, can't hear. When he grows up, somebody comes and kills him. So will you go and tell the judge, oh me Lord, give the murderer less punishment because my brother had two senses less? You will tell him, give him a bigger punishment. He was a masoom, he was sinless. How did he kill my brother? So Islamic logic doesn't work like that, two senses less or two senses more. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Baqarah chapter 2, verse number 168, eat of the good things I've provided you. What is good you can have? What is not good, you cannot have. If you analyze that, if you don't kill these cattle, life cycle of the cattle is very short. They reproduce very fast. If you don't kill the cattle for food, you'll have a problem of overpopulation of the cattle. The cow and the goat, they reproduce very fast. And if an Indian does not want to have non-veg, I've got no problem. If you don't want to have non-veg, brother, no problem at all. Personally, I'm happy. Because if all the Indians and the Hindus start having non-veg, then the price of meat will go high.
Can we have the next question from the sister's side? I see there is... I cannot offend my Muslim sisters anymore. We can give you a chance. Yes, sister, you can ask the question.
Assalamu alaikum. The question is not really related to your topic, but one of the sisters here would like you to elaborate on this. We feel that by sending our children to secular schools, they are losing their Islamic values. However, there are many other sisters who feel it's fine to send them to secular schools as long as they are taught Islam at home. Please comment.
The sister posed the question. I do agree it's out of the topic. The chairperson gave her a chance, so I have to answer. She said that, is it right if we send our children to secular schools and teach Islam at home? Sister, secular by definition means nothing to do with God. If you send your children to secular school nothing to do with God, but I know what you meant. What you meant was non-Islamic schools run by Christian missionaries or others. Secular school by definition means nothing to do with God. So if you send to a school with nothing to do with God, those are atheists, there'll be a problem. They will teach there's no God, you will teach at home, there is God, there'll be conflict. The child will have a problem. Similarly, if you send to other schools which teach wrong things, who teach to worship other besides God. So there they worship Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, every day in the morning, and you come and say that worshiping Jesus Christ is shirk. So the child will get confused. You know what we are doing? It is we who are creating problems in the children. We are to blame. It is the duty of the parents to give an atmosphere which is the right atmosphere. It is like you're tying your children, tying the hands and the leg, putting them in the swimming pool and say, swim. How will you swim? So sister, my advice is, we do require the worldly knowledge. It's important. The first guidance of our Creator Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran to humankind in Surah Iqra, chapter 96, verse number 1, is Iqra. It's to read. It's to educate. Our beloved Prophet said, it is obligated on every Muslim man or woman to acquire knowledge. So knowledge is a must, both knowledge religious as well as the other worldly knowledge, both is important, sister. But be careful while running after the other worldly knowledge. Religious knowledge should not go behind. Both should be there. So best is put your children in schools which do not conflict with the commandment of the Creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the best is schools which teach both. Imagine you go to school and there you're taught about Darwin's theory, we have been created from monkeys. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we have been created from Adam and Eve. Now the child gets confused. How many confusions will you remove? The best is Islamic schools. Unfortunately, there are very few Islamic schools. But alhamdulillah, summa alhamdulillah, now, throughout the world, including India, there are many Islamic schools springing up. Some of good quality, some medium quality, some lower quality. What we should do is that we should support those people who are opening such schools. And alhamdulillah, even our Islam Research Foundation, IRF Educational Trust, has started a school 3 years back in Bombay by the name of Islamic International School. And we are striving so that we can give to our children what we didn't get. What we lacked in our childhood, we have a school we have started, inshallah, besides having the formal education. I don't call it secular. Mathematics is not secular. Science is not secular. I call it formal education because science is an Islamic subject, according to me. Mathematics is Islamic subject. The great mathematicians are Muslims. The great scientists are Muslims. So I don't call science as a secular subject. I call it, for the non-Muslim formal education, Islamically, it's an Islamic subject. But should be taught in the correct perspective. Scientific facts, not hypotheses and theories like Darwin's theory, etc. So sister, it is important that we give our children the right atmosphere and see to it that they get the right education. That's the best. If you try and say that they go to a school which teaches wrong things and then come home and teach the right things about the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the religion, sister, you are playing with fire. I would advise you put in an Islamic school. Hope that answers the question.
The next question from the brother's side at the back.
May peace and mercy of God be upon you all. My name is Saravana Kumar. See, Quran says God exists everywhere. and others also saying God exists everywhere and within everything. And somebody says within ourselves also God is there. And if God exists in everything means, why don't we worship in an ideal? There is also a God, no? Then if not, where God exists? Please explain. Thank you.
The brother asked a very good question. Peace be on you too, brother. Walaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Peace, mercy and blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on you, brother. The brother asked a very good question that even the Quran, it is mentioned that God exists everywhere. The Muslims believe God exists everywhere. Even the Hindus believe God exists everywhere. So what is the harm in worshipping an idol? God exists in the idol, God exists in human beings also. So what is the harm in worshipping an idol? Brother, nowhere in the Quran is it mentioned that God exists everywhere. Nowhere in the Quran is it mentioned God exists everywhere. I am aware there is a misconception amongst many Muslims who assume God exists everywhere. Nowhere does the Quran say they exist everywhere. What the Quran says, Allah's power exists everywhere. Allah has the power. The verse of the Quran, wherever you turn your face, you will see the wajh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The face means the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is capable of controlling anything and everything. But the statement he exists everywhere is not mentioned anywhere in the Quran, neither in any hadith. I am aware that there are certain Muslims, lot of misconception, they believe that. This is nowhere mentioned, but his power exists. Power exists everywhere. Now regarding a question, where does God exist and why can't we worship an idol? Where does God exist? The Quran says, Allah is on the arsh. The hadith where a lady approached and the Prophet asked her, where is God? She said, point on top. God said she has iman, she has faith. So God exists on the arsh, on the throne. The throne exists on the water. He's up in the heavens. So but naturally, he's not in the human being. Yes, he can control. Allah says he's closer to you than your jugular vein. That means he is aware of everything. His power is there. That doesn't mean God himself has come into the jugular vein. That doesn't mean that. It means that Allah has power. He's close to you. That means he loves you. He knows you. He knows everything. He has power over everything. Not even a leaf can fall without the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now coming to your question, why can't we worship idols? If you read the Quran, Quran says in Surah Maidah chapter 5 verse number 90, which I quoted, idol worship is prohibited. Same thing, if you read the Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavad Gita says in chapter number 7 verse number 20, all those with intelligence, yes, you can note down, brother, Bhagavad Gita chapter number 7 verse number 20, all those whose intelligence has been stolen by material desires, they worship demigods. So materialistic people, they do idol worship. If you read the Chandogya Upanishad, chapter number 6, section number 2, verse number 1, it says, Ikkam Evidityam. It's a Sanskrit quotation which means, God is only one without a second. It's mentioned in the Shweta Sitara Upanishad, chapter number 6, verse number 9. Na chasya kasij janita na chadipa. Of him, there are no lords. He has got no parents. Almighty God has got no father. He has got no mother. Almighty God has got no superior. He has got no master. It's mentioned in the Shweta Sitara Upanishad, chapter number 4, verse number 19. Na tasya pratima asti. Of him, there is no likeness. It's further repeated in the Yajurveda, chapter number 32, verse number 3. Na tasya pratima asti. Of him, there are no images. Almighty God has got no images. So the moment you make an image of Almighty God, you're going against the Veda, you're going against Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita, Vedas, all the scriptures, they speak against idol worship. For the detail, you can come to my talk on, not tomorrow, next Sunday, 18th of January, on similarities between Hinduism and Islam, and I'll deal with this topic in detail. So even idol worship is prohibited in Hinduism. Why do they do? The Hindu scholars have a certain logic, which you can reply to that also. You come for my talk, similarities between Hindu and Islam, and inshallah you'll get more knowledge on this aspect. Hope that answers the question.
The same question was answered. If you have a counter question on that?
I have a doubt on that. Sir, first of all, you have misunderstood my question. I'm not here to contradict Islam, or nor am I advocate of Hinduism or anything. My question is just based on your speech. You said it was wrong to kill animal for pleasure, right? So I just want to know that eating out of, suppose I'm thinking mutton is tasty, sort of my own personal pleasure, I'm killing animal. Is it wrong? I'm not trying to contradict you or put you into the doubt. Just want to know your point of view, that's all.
Brother, you're most welcome to ask any question. I don't feel hurt at all. I know you're not contradicting. Even if you contradict, no problem, brother. It's my job. I'm a dai. It's my profession. You can criticize me. You can criticize the Quran. I'm young, but I can take it, alhamdulillah. No problem, brother. I don't get agitated. You can ask any questions. No problem, brother. The question he said that, when I said in my talk, that you cannot kill for pleasure of hunting, I said, for pleasure, hunting, you cannot kill any animal just without any purpose, or pleasure of hunting. Here, we don't eat non-veg only for taste, we eat for our sustenance. So if you say we can't eat animals, we can't eat plants also, what will we eat? How will we survive? How will we survive? So,
clarify. I'm not asking if I'm eating it for necessity. Suppose I think, okay, this animal food is going to be tasty. I want to kill it for my personal pleasure alone. Not I'm feeling of hunger or nothing. Is it also a sin?
If it's for eating tasty food also no problem. You have to eat. If you don't eat, you can't survive. If you don't eat, you can't survive. So Almighty God, as mentioned in Manusmriti, chapter number 5, verse number 30. Some animals have been created to eat, some to be eaten.
Mentioned in Manusmriti, I have not read it.
No, but I have read it.
I'm not interested in knowing about that.
I'm just asking your point of view. Is it wrong to kill
an
animal on the basis of just merely taste pleasure?
It is not wrong at all to kill an animal even if you want to have tasty, as long as it is for food.
Okay, thank
Why?
You.
Why? Because Quran gives permission in Surah Maida, chapter 5, verse number 1. Manusmriti gives, you do not know, but I want to tell people that I believe in this part of Manusmriti. Other part I may not believe. But this part of Manusmriti I believe, chapter 5, verse 30, that Almighty God created some animals to eat, some to be eaten. So if you eat the animals which have been created to be eaten, you're not doing a sin. So similarly, Quran also says certain animals have been created to be eaten. But if you eat the other animals which have not been created for eating, then it's a sin. So those cattle, like sheep, etc., which are permitted in the Quran, that if you eat for food, even if it's tasty food, no problem. Some people want to have vegetable, tasty vegetable. Some people like brinjal. Some people like ladyfinger. So no problem. If I agree with you that nothing should be eaten, then you will have to kill either the plant or the animal. So while eating, if you're eating good things, as long as you're not wasting. If you waste food, it is wrong. If you waste food, it is wrong. So if you kill for eating, for sustenance, even if it's tasty, no problem, it's permitted. It's mentioned in the Quran, Surah Maida, chapter 5, verse number 1, Surah Nahl, chapter 16, verse number 5, as well as Surah Mu'minun, chapter 23, verse 21. Hope that answers the question.
Can we have the next brother?
Okay, brother. What's the question?
One more question, sir. See, the world has shrunk only at the present age, a few decades back or a few centuries back. I don't think so. The preaching of Islam was throughout the world, right? You said it was wrong to associate any followers with God. It's the greatest sin. But a person brought up in some part of the world, telling that, okay, this is Lord Shiva, Lord Vishnu, or Jesus, whatever, he's led into believing that, okay, that is only God. Is he also committing a sin?
A very good question that I asked, that the world is so big and Islam just 14 years back, according to him, and people may not know about Islam. Somebody believes in Shiva as Lord or Brahma as Lord. So what's the problem? Someone believes that Jesus Christ is God. What's wrong? I, being a student of comparative religion, besides Quran saying it is wrong, even the Hindu scripture says, and the Christian scriptures regarding Jesus is God, I quoted. So if the Christian scripture says it is wrong, so why should the Christian worship? Tomorrow someone calls you God. Someone calls me God. Would I would agree? What we have to do, what is wrong regarding calling Brahma as God or Shiva as God. If you analyze these statements, I mentioned Rigveda, book number 2, hymn number 1, verse number 3. There are no less than 33 attributes given to Almighty God in Rigveda, book 2, hymn 1 alone. One of them is Brahma. Brahma is called creator. God. If you translate creator to Arabic, it means Khalik. We Muslims have got no objection if someone says Almighty God is Khalik or Creator or Brahma. But if someone says Brahma is Almighty God who has got four heads and on each head is a crown, we Muslims take strong objection to it. Moreover, you are going against Yajurved, chapter number 32, verse number 3, which says, Na tasya patima asti, of that God there are no images. Same thing Vishnu. Vishnu is called sustainer God. If you translate sustainer or cherisher into Arabic, Rab. We Muslims have got no objection if someone calls Almighty God as Rab or Sustainer or Cherisher or Vishnu. But if you say Vishnu is Almighty God who's traveling on a couch of snakes, he has got four hands, one hand is a discus, left hand he has a conch, he's traveling on a bird by the Garuda, we take strong objection to it. Moreover, you're going against
Sweta Sitara Upanishad, chapter number 4, verse number 19, which says, Natasya Pratimasti, of him there are no images. So brother, if certain people follow wrong things, if they follow Brahma as the creator who has got no images, the almighty, without associating partners, there's no problem. Regarding a question that people may not know Islam, Islam, brother, as I said in my talk, is not a new religion which came into existence 14 years back. It is there since time immemorial. And Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, also taught Islam. He said, not my will, Gospel of John, chapter 5, verse 30, not my will, but the will of my Father. Anyone who says, not my will, but the will of Almighty God, is a Muslim. So Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was a Muslim. He taught nothing but submitting a will to God, which if you translate into Arabic means Islam. Adam, peace be upon him, taught nothing but submitting a will to Almighty God. Noah taught nothing but submitting a will to Almighty God. Moses taught nothing but submitting a will to Almighty God. Jesus taught nothing but submitting a will to Almighty God. May peace be upon them all. If you translate into Arabic, it is Islam. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the last and final messenger. He was not sent only for the Muslims or the Arabs. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 107, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ, that we have sent thee not but as a mercy to the whole of humanity, as a mercy to the whole of mankind, as a mercy to all the creatures, as a mercy to all the worlds. Therefore, it is the duty of every Muslim. I ended my talk by saying the quotation of the Quran of Surah Al-Imran, chapter 3, verse 110, which says, it is the duty of every Muslim to convey the message of Islam to the others. And Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Fusilat, chapter number 41, verse number 53, Allah says, Sanurihim ayatina fil afaqi wa fi anfusihim hatta yatabayyana annahu al-haq, that soon we shall show them our signs in the furthest regions of the horizons and into their souls, until it is clear to them that this is the truth. There may be some people living in some far-off island which no one may have heard about Islam according to you. Allah says, he will put the message of the Creator in everyone's heart, by the signs and the horizons and into the soul. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator, he himself will give the message of submitting the will to God directly. So even if we don't do the job, yet he will get the message. And then if you reject it, you will be a loser. If you accept it, you have passed this test. Hope that answers the question.
Can we have the next question from the sister's side?
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. If Allah knows that people will do sins when they are sent back again to earth after removing the thoughts of hellfire, why did he not show the mankind, that even to people of today's generation, that these are his punishments, so that people seeing them by their own eyes fear Allah and go in right path?
Sister has a very good question. That if you see the real thing in the next life, in the hereafter, see the hellfire, everyone will believe that we should have believed we made a mistake. But Allah cannot send them back and wash their memory, because they will again commit the same sin. So why doesn't Allah show them here? That's a very good question. Sister, Allah does give trials over here also. Allah has mentioned in the Quran about the hellfire. But what say, are kon hell mein jayenga? Fire hai kya nahi hai? We think that where is Jannah? Where is it? We see that afterward. So we don't believe in it. Allah has told, but we don't believe in it. Regarding trials, Allah gives you trailer, you know, highlights. Here, for example, AIDS. Allah says in the Quran, he has punished many of the people, many qawm, many nations previously, and he extinguished completely qawm Lut and various qawms. Even today, you know, AIDS came in the 80s, early 80s. It's a punishment. Punishment from Allah. Acquired immune deficiency syndrome, AIDS. That's a punishment. First homosexuals got it, then heterosexuals got it, do outside their marriage. So here we find Allah gives us signs. All these are signs. For example, Bosnia. It's a calamity. The people of Bosnia. Two ways. Some people did wrong. People are Muslims. How are they? Were they practicing? Most of them weren't practicing Muslims. They didn't know Islam. So Allah gives signs. There may be good people also in Bosnia. So Allah says, when he gives this punishment, even those who don't do sin may get punished. For them it's a test. The calamity, when Allah sends a calamity, even those people who are not sinful, Allah says in the Quran, even the calamity may befall them. But that's for them a test. So here, all these are tests, sister. What's happening in the world today? Bosnia, what's happening? You see the other part, what's happening in Iraq? All these are tests. But where do we human beings reflect? We say, wo to Bosnia mein ho raha hai, India mein thodi ho raha hai. Wo to Gujarat mein ho raha hai, Madras mein thodi ho raha hai. So all these are signs, sister. Allah is giving you tailors. And if you read this book, the last and final guidance, and we realize it, then we realize he is the creator, he alone should be worshipped, and we always say, Alhamdulillah, whatever he has given us. Hope that answers the question.
Can we have the next question from Deepa? We have time for a couple of questions more. The last two questions. Yes, brother.
Assalamu alaikum, sir. This is perhaps my first meeting with Dr. Zakir Naik, and I'm very convinced by his speech.
Can we have your name and your profession,
Murtuza.
Please?
Murtuza is my name, and I'm doing my MBA. So I had a small question, sir. You have told me that Allah Pak knows that what each of us are going to do, what each of us are going to do next, why this world has been created, and where we lead to, what am I going to do the next moment, also has been decided. Okay? So, is this word test justified? Because the very fact, whenever we use the word test, logically speaking, it is perhaps an event where the consequences are not known. So in wherever we use the word test, that this world is a test, so are we justifying? Because if we already know, if Allah Pak knows what is the consequence is going to be, where each of us are heading to, and what each of us are going to be, so why are we here? And
you understood the question, brother.
So
one question at a time, please.
No, I just want to complete this thing, sir.
You complete the question.
Yeah. And you are the scientist, and if you have an experiment, and you know what is the consequence is going to be, so why the experiment and why do you want to do it?
The brother has asked a question. Inshallah, if the non-Muslim should come up first on the microphone, we prefer non-Muslim asking the question. Volunteers should see to it that non-Muslim should be brought front. If any non-Muslims, you're most welcome. You can walk through, you can break the queue, come in front. It will be preferable. Brother Murtaza asked a question that when a test takes place, the consequence is not known. If the consequence is known, where is the test? If a scientist does the experiment, he doesn't know the result. If he knows the result, then what's the test? Very good. No one is testing Allah. Allah knows the consequences, but Allah is not undergoing the test. We are undergoing the test. And you and I don't know the consequence. I don't know my consequence. I don't know I'm going to go to Jannah. If I had known I was going to go to Jannah, I wouldn't have come all the way to Madras. I travel throughout the world. I sweat it out. I don't know. My Jannah is not secured. If my Jannah was secured, then why would I have left my medical profession and flogged out here and this? I don't know. I'm not sure I'm going to go to Jannah. I'm asking for the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Be merciful, put me in Jannah. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I cannot say, oh, I'm a great guy, I'll go to Jannah. The consequences is not known to the person who undergoes the test. You do not know whether you go to hell or heaven. I don't know. But Allah knows. And you may have missed out the point in my lecture that when the teacher takes the examination, many a time the teacher knows the consequences. Teacher knows this student is going to come out first. Teacher knows he's going to fail. So do you mean to say, I will not sit for the examination? The test is yours. The test is not for the teacher. And when the scientist does the experiment, the scientist doesn't know the result. Therefore, he does the experiment. Yeah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not a scientist. Allah is not experimenting on us. There's a mistake. Allah is not experimenting on us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator, the best to create. He is given, made a creation, the human beings who has the free will. He knows. But the reason he's letting us go in this world, because if he does not let you undergo this test, on the day of judgment, you will ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, why did you put me in hell? If Allah puts you in hell, Allah alam, I don't know. So you'll object. So because of that, I said in my lecture that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is just. So Allah is not undergoing the test. Allah doesn't require us. Allah is already the greatest. We are undergoing the test and we don't know the results. Because we don't know the results, that's the reason we are striving. And we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, may He grant us mercy, may He forgive us, and may He put us in Jannah. Ameen.
And we have the next question from the brother here.
I am Saktivel, doing B.Tech in MIT. Sir, you are told that God told I can forgive any sin other than accepting a partner to me. To Islams only, they are praying Allah. Other than that, for Hindus that and all, we are not following Allah that and all. So, we are sinners in your point of view.
The brother asked the question that Allah says He may forgive any sin if He wants. Not that He will forgive. That doesn't mean that if you believe in Allah, you can do any sin. If He wants, He can forgive you. But the sin of shirk, He'll never forgive. Regarding other non-Muslims or worshipping anyone besides Allah, Allah means the true one God. You may call Him by any name. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Isra, chapter 17, verse 110, Qulidullah Abidur Rahman, Ayyamata Dufal al Asmaul Husna. Say, call upon Him by Allah or by Rahman. By whichever name you call upon Him, to Him belong the most beautiful names. But the concept should be correct. He should not be begotten, He should be one. If you worship the true Almighty God, whichever name you call, but it should be a good name. Correct concept, no problem. But if you worship thieves, if you associate partners, like if someone says Jesus Christ, peace be upon Him, is God,
we consider him to be a messenger of God. If you call him God, then not only a sinner, it is the biggest sin. According to the Quran, not according to me, according to the Quran, Surah Nisa, chapter 4, verse 48, Surah Nisa, chapter 4, verse 116. Not only according to the Quran, even according to the Bible. Even according to the Bible, Almighty God says in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 5, verse number 7, 9, thou shalt not make image of Almighty God, it's a sin. Even according to Rig Veda, it's a sin. According to Yajurveda, chapter 32, verse number 3, it's a sin. So not only Quran says it's a sin, even the Hindu scripture says it's a sin. Suppose a Muslim says, I believe in Allah, and he starts worshipping Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, na'uz billah. Suppose a lunatic, he says, I believe in Allah, but he worships Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and says, even he will not go to Jannah. Same way, if a Christian worships Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, though the Bible says he should not be worshipped, your Vedas says he should not be worshipped. So according to your Vedas, you will be a sinner. According to Bhagavad Gita, you will be a sinner. According to the Upanishads, you will be a sinner. According to the Quran, you will be a sinner. According to the Bible, you will be a sinner. Hope that answers the question.
About creator and creation. Sir, I want to know.
Your name, please.
Muhammad Ishaq.
Any non-Muslims in the ladies' side? This? Okay, brother, you can continue with your question.
Human beings, mostly Muslims, are punished. Taken from Bosnia to Kashmir in Iraq. Mr. Zakir told me that even in world they are punished. Sir, is there anything that for one sin in the world also punished and in the Akhirat din also be punished?
Well, that was the question that Muslims are being punished everywhere. In Bosnia we're being punished, in other parts of the world. They're punished there also and punished in Akhirat also. If a Muslim is a true Muslim means, what is the meaning of Muslim? Not Zakir, Sultan, Abdullah. Muslim means one who submits himself to Almighty God. For a true Muslim, these calamities are a test. It's not a punishment. And the maximum calamities came on the prophets. In the Akhirah, they will get Jannah. But if you are a namesake Muslim, who say your name is Abdullah, Zakir, and Muhammad, etc., but namesake Muslim, but don't follow commandments, you can get punished here, and even can get punished there. Because Allah says in the Quran in Surah Al-Imran chapter 3 verse 185, Kullu nafsin zaiqatul maut. Every soul shall have a taste of death. But the final recompense will be on the day of judgment. So you may get part punishment here, the balance is there. Part punishment. This is Bosnia, small part punishment. Balance is there. So final is there. Or you may get a calamity. You may get test calamities here, but in Akhirah you may get Jannah. So if you follow the commandments, you're on the true path. Whatever comes, you say, Alhamdulillah. Hope that answers the question.
Okay, brother, you can ask a question. We have a non-Muslim brother.
Yeah. Hello, I'm Vivek. I'm a software engineer. And I have certain... today's lecture was very good. In Quran, as far as I've read, in one chapter, it says that Allah says to Jesus that, have you told to the people to worship yourself and your mother as part of Trinity? That means, that puts that Quran believes that Mary and Jesus are part of Trinity. No Christians believe like that.
The brother asked a very good question. The Quran says that Jesus Christ never told the people that you worship me and my mother as God. No Christian believes that Mother Mary is God. Brother, your knowledge of Christianity is limited. There are more than thousands of denominations in Christianity. Thousands. Thousands. Even I don't know all. And there's a denomination known as Marymites, who believe in the Trinity. One of the form of Trinity is Mother Mary. They believe Mother Mary to be God, though there are very few now. Now they exist or I don't know. But if you read the books of Christianity, it talks about a sect, a denomination, which believe that Mother Mary was God. Hope that answers the question.
But I'm a basic Christian. So... but according to the whole Bible, I never have found out the place that where Jesus says that worship my mother or it is like that.
Brother says he's a practicing Christian. He never found in the Bible where Jesus said that worship Mary, peace be upon him. Neither did Jesus say worship Jesus, peace be upon him. But yet you worship. The Quran doesn't say what Bible says. What Quran says, say to the people, some people worship. So same way Bible says, that never did the Bible say that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said unequivocal statement in the complete Bible where Jesus Christ, peace be upon himself, said that worship me, I am God. But yet the Christians worship. You don't worship, Alhamdulillah, I congratulate you. If you don't worship Jesus Christ as God, Alhamdulillah, then you're coming closer to Islam. And Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said in the Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 11 to 12, I have got many things to say unto you, but ye cannot bear them now. For he, when the Spirit of truth shall come, he shall guide you unto all truth. He shall not speak of himself, all that he hears shall he speak. He shall glorify me, talking about another messenger to come, talking about the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So believe in the Bible, you also have to believe in the last messenger mentioned in the Bible, that is Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Hope that answers the question.
The next question from here, brother.
Good evening, sir. My question is, why should God create us? Why should he keep the test? Why should he send us to hell or heaven?
Brother, that was the question, why should God create us? Why should he send here? The whole talk was on that. That's what I told you. The whole talk was based on that. That why should God create us? To test us, etc. Now someone appears for an examination. MBBS examination. Yes, that's what I'm doing. Brother, the whole talk was based on that. And if you...
Why should he create us? What is the need for him?
Okay, fine. Why should he create us as human beings? Okay, that's a very good question. That why should he create us as human beings? I'll give a different angle to it. Because if you analyze, Allah says in the Quran, that when Allah asks that who would like to be sent as a human being, the mountains and all, they said no. But the human beings were fools who said, no, we want to become human beings. Because the other creation, they don't have a free will of their own. Like angels, no free will, okay, they are good. But if you become a human being, you have a free will. If you have a free will and then if you obey Allah, then you become higher than the angels. If you have a free will and don't obey, then you fail. So we human beings were fool, including me, myself. We said, we want to get distinction, high marks. So Quran says, we human beings are fool, who said we want to undergo the test and now we are tested. You won't come to know now. On the day of judgment, Allah will give you that memory. So Allah says in the Quran, and Allah testified in Surah Araf, chapter number 7, verse number 172. He brought the children of Adam from the loins, and Allah says, and testified, do you agree there's one God? He said, yes, we agree. Now the memory has washed out. On the day of judgment, again it will come back to you. So we were the fools who said we want to undergo the test. Now somebody wants to sit for an MBBS examination. The teacher said, sit. If you have got admission in the medical college, no problem. Now you sit. If he fails, that's his problem. If he passed, that's his problem. You understand? And the test is different. What question has to be given? That is the choice of the teacher. You can't tell, oh teacher, why have you given me this question? That is the prerogative of the teacher. Whether he wants to give you question number 1, question number 2, whether he wants to give you a question from chapter number 3 or chapter number 5. Therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives different questions to different people in this test. Some people he makes rich, some people he makes poor, some people healthy, some people are diseased. Different people he tests different way, but depending upon the way he tests them, the correction is like that. If the test is difficult, the teacher corrects the paper leniently. If the paper is easy, the teacher corrects the paper very strictly. Same way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, depending upon the facility he gives the different human being, he tells them accordingly and he is the most just. Hope that answers the question.
We'll take one. Do you have a question, brother?
All right.
We'll take one last question from you and we'll conclude the program then.
This is regarding the lecture. You told in one place that angels do not have free will. But somewhere in Quran, I read that Iblis was not willing to bow down to Adam when Allah told. So that is his free will. He took it like that.
MashaAllah. Our brother Vivek is very learned. Yeah, that's the Quran, MashaAllah. Our brother Vivek has read the Quran. And I do agree with him, Surah Baqarah. He's quoting the verse of the Quran from Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 34. He says, we told to the angels, bow down, all bow down except Iblis. This is mentioned not only in Surah Baqarah, it is mentioned minimum 7 times in the Quran. In Surah Araf, chapter number 7, Surah Hijr, chapter number 15, Surah Qahf, chapter number 18. Same thing. We told to the angels, bow down, all bow down except Iblis. So now Iblis objected. So from this we come to know that Iblis, if we read the translation, we understand Iblis for the angel. We think. But if you read in Surah Qahf, chapter number 18, verse number 50, it says that we asked to the angels bow down, all bow down except Iblis. Iblis was amongst the jinn. You understand? So Iblis was the jinn. So now you tell me, brother Zakir, 7 places Allah said to the angels, bow down, all bow down except Iblis, means angel. Now one place in the Quran says he was a jinn. So there's a contradiction. Correct? It's a contradiction because this is the translation. In Arabic language, there is a law called as law of taglib. Taglib means if the majority is addressed, the minority need not be addressed. For example, if there are 99 doctors and 1 engineer, and if I say all doctors stand up, Even that engineer will stand up. Because in the law of Taghlib, in Arabic grammar, the majority is addressed, minority is addressed. I need not say all doctors and one engineer stand up. But in English language, if I say all doctors stand up, only doctors will stand up, that one engineer will not stand. So nowhere does the Quran say that Iblis was an angel, nowhere. We, because of the translation and lack of Arabic knowledge, we think, we assume. Many of the Muslims also assume. But the Quran clarifies in Surah Kahf, chapter 18, verse number 50, that Iblis was a jinn. And jinn, like the human beings, have a free will. So, amongst the angels, there was one jinn also present, who was Iblis. He was very pious. But his arrogance, that why should I bow down to Adam? He's made from mud. I'm made from fire. Arrogance. That made him disobey Almighty God. He was a jinn. Even human beings and jinn both have a free will. They can disobey God. So here they disobey God. And that's the reason he was taken out. And he is the biggest Satan. And now he tries to attract the people who are on the path of God. And tries to distract them from the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I hope that answers the question.
We have to... No, I know, but we have to close. Okay. Okay, go ahead fast.
I am Mohammad Khaja Modin, retired officer, Madras University. Assalamu alaikum, Haji Dr. Zakir Nair Sahib. Sir, you have told that you have opened Islamic International School in Bombay. I request you, why not you open Islamic School in Chennai and other parts of the places, because this is the need of the day today, sir. Thank you, sir.
Whether you give me the land and give me the funds, inshallah, I'll open it.
Thank you very much, brothers and sisters. Shukran, jazakallah khair.